Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. In this very series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try to discuss them with the help of different questions. Before moving on to question number one, for all those who are watching this video for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and notifications. You can also join our Telegram group. In this very group, we share some free quizzes, the updates for all our videos, and you can also post your queries over here. Moving on to question number one, which says, India's stock market capitalization recently hit 3 trillion fueled by a rally in small and mid-cap stocks on the Bombay Stock Exchange. Which of the following statements are correct about the mid-cap stocks? So let's discuss a bit about this first and then we'll discuss the question again. So recently it was in news that the market capitalization of the Bombay Stock Exchange has hit a 3 trillion benchmark. Okay, so this is because of the rally in the small and mid-cap stocks. People have seen good prospects in these small and mid-cap stocks and they have started investing in them. So if I talk about how has this market capitalization rise been possible, it is because of the easing COVID concerns. So the COVID pandemic was at peak recently, but now the cases have begun to fall again. Okay, so the second wave of pandemic has hit our economy a lot, but now the cases have begun to be below the 3 lakh mark for the fifth day in a row since mid-April. So recently the cases have fallen and there are chances that the restrictions, the curbs in the form of lockdowns and all, they will be eased once these cases decline even further. So the hopes that these restrictions will be removed, the things will get more better, has led to good future prospects of the investment in these stocks. So the visibility of economic recovery improved as industrial activities continued even during the lockdown, and now restrictions are likely to ease. So agar restrictions ease ho jayenge, if the restrictions will be removed, the consumer demand will come up, so economy will be back on the track. So the investors are feeling that the markets can have good prospects, so they have started investing. They had the money and thus they are looking forward to invest. Now where they are investing? They are investing more in the small and mid caps, and out of them also more in mid caps. See, compared to the large cap, the prices of mid cap are less and they offer you really very good option. They have cheaper valuations and if the markets will do very well, obviously you will earn a lot on them. Moreover, these mid cap are likely to turn into large caps in future. So the investors, their risk appetite is also growing. So when at cheaper valuation, they can buy mid cap stocks, being able to bear some extent of risks, then they prefer these kinds of stocks. So I am again and again saying that the market cap has risen and people are investing in mid cap stocks and small cap stocks. So what are these? Let us discuss a bit about those concepts as well. So this was recently news. These are the clippings from your Economic Times newspaper, and which talked about the bull run, that is the Indian market cap hits 3 trillion mark. So first time when we hit the 1 trillion mark was 14 years ago in 2007, where on 28th May we reached the $1 trillion benchmark. And now and then in 2017 we reached the 2 trillion mark, and now in 2021 we have finally reached the 3 trillion mark. Now the companies which are contributing to this rise in the market cap include some major giants like Reliance Industries, TCS, HDFC, Infosys, Hindustan Unilever, etc. Obviously the large cap companies are doing really very well, but the small caps and mid caps are also not behind. Unki wajah se bhi ye hamara bull run aaya hai. Then they're talking about the countries which lead India in terms of market cap are US, China, Hong Kong, Japan, UK, France and Canada. So these seven countries are ahead of India in terms of market cap, but India is still among top 10 in terms of market capitalization. So if this scenario continues, if the COVID cases reduce, if the prospects of future growth are there, then we are likely to see a more bull rise. The Sensex, our stocks can rise more by the end of this year, and our market cap can reach 3.5 trillion as well. Moreover, the disinvestments are going on. So if LIC and other companies, their disinvestment happen, they get listed, then it will add another $200 billion to your market cap. So if this can help India to surpass the France and Canada. India market cap mein ho sakta hai, France aur Canada ke bhi ahead aa jayega agar ye 3.5 trillion ka trademark ko reach kar jayega. So let us discuss what is this market cap which we are talking about. Market cap ka matlab kya hota hai? In simple words, it's the product of your outstanding shares of the company with the current market price. So company ke kitne shares hai outstanding, usko jab aap current market price se multiply kar dete ho, to wo aapka market capitalization hota hai. Ek tarah se ye ek measure hai jisse aap company ko value kar sakte ho. Is company ki kitni value hai, jiska zyada market cap hai uski zyada value hai vis-a-vis jiska kam hai. So it's a measure of valuation of the company. Now the companies that are traded on a stock exchange, they can be categorized under three major broad categories, which include the large cap, the mid cap and the small cap. So very briefly discussing about these large cap company. So you can, in simple words, if you want to understand, you can think that large cap are the big companies, mid cap are the middle scale companies, and small caps are the small companies, the startups and all. So large companies are those businesses which have been operating for a while, they are doing really very well, they are well reputed, have great image in the market, and thus people have faith in them and invest in those companies. So the companies which are well established businesses, have significant market share, are large cap companies. To provide a proper threshold, the companies whose market cap is really very large, that is more than 20,000 crores. So 20,000 crore ya usse zyada ka agar aapka market capitalization hai, then you are categorized under a large cap company. So these companies dominate the industry, they are very stable. Okay, if the things are not doing well in the economy, there is a recession or there is some negative event, obviously such companies will be affected, but to a really very lesser extent vis-a-vis mid-cap or small-cap. So these are the stable range. They can perform well during tough times as well. That's why they are not very volatile to the fluctuations happening in the economy. So they will usually have a functioning, they have been functioning for decades and have good reputation in the market. So they are not that very risky. So if you want to have a risk-free or less risk option, then you can invest in these stocks. By taking less risk, you can invest them, and it's a really very good option in that regard. The volatility is less compared to the mid cap or the small cap stocks. Okay, the volatility, the lower volatility makes them less risky. वो इतने volatile नहीं होती fluctuation से, इसलिए वो इतने risky भी नहीं होते हैं. So Reliance Industries, Infosys, ये कुछ big companies हैं जिनका market cap बहुत ज़्यादा है. Talking about India, then if I talk about mid cap stocks, so the stocks whose the companies whose market cap is less than 20,000 crores but more than 5,000 crores are mid-cap companies. So if the company will have a market cap of less than 5,000 crores, then it will be a small cap. So 5,000 crore tak ki company small cap mein aati hai, 5 to 20,000 se kam wali mid-cap mein, aur 20,000 aur usse zyada wali large cap stocks mein aa jati hai companies. So if you want to invest in mid cap, obviously it will be a bit riskier vis-a-vis the large cap stocks, and because they tend to be more volatile as compared to the large cap companies, but still they are really very good option, and they are likely to become the large cap in future, so you can invest in them. On the other hand, mid cap companies have ability to turn into large cap, which makes the investors interested in them to invest. The companies offer high growth potential also than do large cap stocks, and hence more investors are attracted to such companies. So Metropolis Healthcare, Castrol India, LIC Housing Finance, and many are such examples. Small caps are smaller in size, but they have great growth potential. Koi startup aaya, abhi size mein chota hai, but over time wo bahut zyada expand kar sakta hai. So that's a small cap. What makes them risky is is the low probability that they will be successful over time. नई नई कंपनी आई, कोई छोटी कंपनी आई, सो अभी डाइसी है कि वो फ्यूचर में सक्सीड करेगी कि नहीं करेगी. सो इट्स फीलिंग वेरी डाइसी दैट इट माइट और माइट नॉट सक्सीड इन फ्यूचर, विच मेक्स देम रिस्की, विच इज दैट्स वाई द स्टॉक्स ऑफ सच कंपनीज आर वॉलेटाइल इन नेचर, बट स्टिल दे हैव ग्रेट ग्रोथ प्रॉस्पेक्ट्स एंड दस these days the investments in the small caps and mid caps are also rising. So this was the concept. Moving back to our question, which of the following statements are correct about the mid caps? So the mid cap companies are those with market cap above 10,000 but less than 25. Yes, then investing in these companies can be, is it yes? No, here it was 5,000 crores. So this statement is incorrect. Then, so these are small things which you might miss on while reading the question. Okay, so although this limit, these limits have been stated incorrectly over here. 5,000 and 20,000 crore was the limit. At times they might confuse you where they might write 20,000 here, but here the value might be wrong. So be thorough with your concepts. Second one says investing in them can be riskier vis-a-vis large cap. This is correct. Third is the companies of a high growth potential and have the ability to turn into large cap. Yes. So the second and third are correct. Answer is option D. Moving on to question number two, it says what does it refer to? So let's identify the concept from here. It is a basic technical indicator that occurs in market when short-term moving average of an asset rises above the long-term average. And many investors consider it one of the most definitive signals of a bull market. So what is being talked about over here? A technical indicator is being talked about over here, which signals bull market. Okay. So if the indicator which we are talking about is the golden crossover. So let's discuss about it a bit. Recently, it was in news that the Nifty Small Cap Index has crossed the golden crossover. Okay, it has formed the golden crossover on 24th May for the first time. So, jo Nifty ke small cap stocks ki index hai, wo recently golden crossover mark usne reach kiya hai for the first time in 7 years, and it has raised the possibility that for gaining in short term in near future. If I talk about the mid cap stocks index, Nifty के जो mid cap stocks की index थी वो already ये mark, ये pattern form कर चुकी है March में, okay? And now we have seen small caps forming this very crossover pattern. So Nifty small cap 100 index is up by 29.5% in 2021 and the mid cap by 22.4%, but your Nifty has gained 8.7%. So when your small caps have reached the golden crossover pattern, it denotes that we are likely to see records high in these small cap index soon. So people, when this small cap index is showing the golden crossover pattern, people will become more interested in investing in these small cap stocks, and when they will invest in them more, they will basically reach even record high values. So the small caps and mid caps are likely to outperform the large caps as well. But what is this golden crossover? If I talk about this, it's a technical indicator which occurs in the market when your short-term moving average of an asset rises above the long-term moving average. So, agar aap short-term mein dekhoge ki aapka jo bhi stocks hain wo kaise move kar rahe hain, to unka jo movement hai, okay, uska level, uska average jo hai wo long-term movement se zyada hai. So if you compare a 50-day average of the index, how it is moving, and compare it with a 200-day moving average, then 50-day average is more. So how is this helpful? What does it denote? Agar aapka short-term average jo hai, wo zyada hai long-term average se, to wo ye denote karta hai ki short run mein aapko aage aane wale time mein achhe profits mil sakte hain, future mein achhe prospects ho sakte hain, to aapko invest karna chahiye, aapko khareedne chahiye stocks. So how is it is helpful? It is helpful because when traders see the golden crossover occur, they view the chart pattern as indicative of strong bull market. Ki aage aane wali market bull market hogi, achha perform karegi, to aapko investment karni chahiye. It occurs when short term average crosses over a long term average to the upside and is interpreted by analysts and traders as signaling an upward turn in the market and suggest a long-term bull market going forward. So, आगे जाके अभी आपको short-term में भी gains होंगे और over time long-term में market आपकी अच्छी grow होगी. many investors consider it as one of the most definitive signals of bull market, and they consider it to be a strongly buy signal. So market agar aapki short term mein outperform kar rahi hai vis-a-vis that in long term, then it signals that future prospects are really very good, markets will perform really well, they will turn bullish, so you should invest. The opposite of golden cross over is the death cross. So it's the inverse, which says that 50 day average is less vis-a-vis the 200 day average. So wo kya indicate karta hai? It indicates a bear market going forward. So market will down perform basically. So this is the concept of golden crossover. Moving on to question number 3. India has attracted highest ever total FDI inflow of $81.72 billion during the financial year 2020-21. Identify the statements which are incorrect. So these are the statements related to FDI. Now I'll very briefly cover the news piece, because these facts have already been covered by Neha ma'am in the morning tail session. But what will be our focus in RBI 247 series? Our focus will be on understanding the concepts. So after discussing the facts in very brief, I'll just move on to the difference between an FDI and FPI. What is FDI? What is FPI? How they are different from each other? So the concepts should be clear to you. FDI inflow has touched nearly $82 billion benchmark. So the FDI inflows in India have risen to the highest ever value of $81.72 billion. So it is 10% higher than what we had in the previous year. Moreover, FDI equity inflow also grew by 19% in this very year. Talking further, the countries which are top investor countries in India, jahan se sabse zyada FDI India ko mila hai, is first Singapore, followed by US and then Mauritius. And the major percentage increase which has happened in the amount of inflow coming to India is from the Saudi Arabia side. Talking about the top FDI destinations which have attracted these investor countries in our country is the Gujarat, followed by Maharashtra and then Karnataka. And the top sectors where this FDI has been attracted include number 1, computer hardware and software, followed by our construction activities and then the services sector. So these were some facts. Now moving on to the difference between an FDI and an FPI. So FDI stands for foreign direct investment and FPI stands for foreign portfolio investment. So when you are making an FDI, what you do, a company in one country, an entity in one country invests in the entity of other country or in the assets of other country, and those assets are used for purpose of having the controlling interest. Okay, so you have control over the production, over the distribution, or over any other activities of the firm. Aap basically management or control chahte ho dusri country ke assets ke over. Un assets ko aap production ke liye, distribution ke liye, aur alag alag activities ke liye use kar sakte ho. But if I talk about foreign portfolio investment, yahan pe hum productive assets mein na invest karke financial assets mein invest karte hain. We invest in stocks, bonds, mutual funds of other countries. So this is more short term in nature vis-a-vis an FDI. So FDI, so this was the first difference. Secondly, FDI is having more of a long term approach. Okay, but your FDI usually is for short term, but you can have plan for long term as well. Talking further, in FDI, you get the investors get the ownership as well as the management right. Suppose you are buying some company in some other country, okay, your objective is to manage that company, have the ownership right. But if you invest in an FPI, suppose a foreign investor invests in some stocks of Reliance in India, so he will be the owner of those shares, okay, but he will not get the management right. He can't manage the Reliance company, he cannot take the decisions for that company, but he will get the ownership right. But if some investor say purchases your Reliance Industries in India, it is a very big example, but it's a hypothetical one. I am saying suppose there is some startup, okay, in some other country. If you making an FDI in other country, invest in that startup, you buy that major stake over there, you can be involved, you will be the owner, you can manage that firm and be involved in the decision making. So that is how FDI and FPI differ. Usually there is a general rule that if you are making an investment of more than 10%, then it is FDI, and when it's less than 10%, it is FPI. But it is not always applicable, it's the general rule, because when you will make a good amount of investment, then only you can have the ownership or the management right. Now, if you want to make investment in India and FDI in India, we have two routes, automatic and the government route. So some companies, if want to make an investment in certain sectors where no government approval is needed, then through automatic route, they can easily enter India. But there are some sectors where if you want to make an FDI, you need government approval. So that's the government route. But still, there are certain sectors which are prohibited sectors where you can't, in these sectors, you cannot make an FDI. So what are those sectors? It include your lottery, gambling, such kinds of businesses, chit fund, nidhi companies, TDRs mein trade karna, real estate business. Okay, then manufacturing cigars, cigarettes, tobacco. And certain sectors are there which are just restricted for your public players and not the private players, like your atomic energy, railway. So all these sectors are where your FDI is prohibited. Moving back to our question, the statements which are incorrect. So FDI is the investment in financial assets. No, it's FPI. So first statement is incorrect. Second says FDI gives investor ownership as well as management right. Yes. Third says investment, Indian government permit 100% FDI for nidhi companies and chit funds. No, these are the prohibited sectors. So first and third are wrong. Answer is option C. The question says incorrect ones were to be identified. Moving on to the last question. In collaboration with the National Payments Corporation of India, the ICICI Bank has launched a facility to link the UPI ID with the digital wallet pockets and thus became the first one to link e-wallet with a UPI network. Which of the following is incorrectly related to this facility? So let's first discuss a bit about this facility. ICICI Bank has launched this facility in collab with the National Payments Corporation of India. So what they have done, they have linked the UPI ID with the e-wallet of ICICI. So UPI ID with e-wallet. What is UPI? Nothing but a unique payment system through which we can link our bank account with the mobile application. We use Google Pay, we use Amazon Pay to make payments. So we can use the UPI to transfer money to our friends, to make the payments. We can pay the utility bills, easily transfer money. So all these facilities have been possible because of UPI. Hum Google Pay kar dete hain, humme koi amount pay karna hota hai. So what happens in that case? When we use UPI, the amount gets deducted from our savings bank account. Hamare bank account se paisa kat jata hai. So how this facility is different? Here UPI is linked with Pockets. Pockets is an e-wallet of ICICI Bank. So the money will not be deducted from your account, from your savings account, rather from your e-wallet. Aapke e-wallet mein jo paisa hoga, wahan se aapka paise katenge when you make a payment through UPI. So jinke paas ICICI Bank ka account nahi hai, wo bhi ye e-wallet use kar sakte hain. E-wallet mein aapke paise honge to aap UPI ke through payments kar sakte ho. So ICICI Bank announced the launch of UPI linking to its digital wallet, making departure from current practice which demands such IDs to be linked to savings bank account. So you don't need to make the payment through savings bank account. When you will make a UPI payment, the amount will get deducted from your e-wallet pockets and not the bank account. So new users who are not customers of the bank can instantly get a UPI ID for their e-wallet, and the customers who already have UPI ID will get new ID when they log on to the Pockets app. Now, why this move has been undertaken, how it can help? There are some transactions which we take, which take place in daily basis. Hum kuch chote mote transactions roz karte rehte hain. So we might not want to show those small transactions in our account statements, in our savings account statements. So there's a need to streamline this transactions. Itni zyada transactions se hum confused na ho, thoda jo short term ya chote mote hum kharche kar rahe hain, wo hum alag jagah dikha sake to declutter our savings account, this move can really be helpful. So it enables user to undertake small value everyday transaction from their pockets. We want to make payment of say daily cab expenditure rupees 100, 200, or we want to pay purchases of some grocery items rupees 50, 60, so that there is no point showing them in your savings account statement. So it's better to streamline such transactions and use your e-wallet to make the transactions. Further, there might be some customers who are not having the bank accounts. For example, the college students, the school going students, for their daily expenses, they need digital platforms, okay? But they might not have the accounts created. So in that case, they can use this e-wallet facility. Now, what things are going to be offered under this initiative? You can scan. Using scanning, you can make the payments like we make through the Bheem UPI. Similarly, we can scan and make the payment through this UPI as well. You can make or receive payment to others. You can receive payments from others, or you can make the payments to them using this UPI. Then you can make payments at the merchant site. Aap online bhi payments kar sakte ho, UPI ID ke through you can make online payments. You can at merchant locations you can make the payments. And you can also make the money transfer. So from one pocket, one person's e-wallet, you can make the transfer to other wallet, or from your e-wallet, you can make the transfer back to your savings account as well. Customers can transfer funds from pocket's wallet to savings account or any other pocket's wallet as well. So moving back to our question, which facility is incorrectly related to this? Answer is C. C states that customers cannot transfer funds from pockets to savings. No, they can transfer. So this is incorrectly related. Answer is option C. This was all for today's session. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.